All right, this is the fourth video of our photosynthesis lecture series where we're going to be focusing on cyclic photosynthesis. This is a version of photosynthesis that developed earlier in the evolutionary process. You will see that it's not actually useful for the long run for the plant, but it does add a little bonus of energy for the plant. And basically, in the reaction we talked about in the video three, we have the non-cyclic version where electrons start from water, and then to replace the electrons lost by photosystems II during the oxidation of the photosystems II by light. And then these electrons are going to go uphill, downhill again, through the actual proton pumping system involving the plastoquinone and the cytochrome complex. Then it's going to go into the photosystems I again, and then bumped up again, and downhill again it goes into the truck. So this process is non-cyclic because the electrons that started from water end up in the truck and they will never come back towards water. So this doesn't happen. That is why it's called non-cyclic. And this is actually what the plant needs to do to survive, because not only does it produce ATP via the proto-motor force we discussed in the previous video, but it also makes the truck that is going to be used to power the Calvin cycle. You need both this NADPH and the ATP to power the Calvin cycle or the light independent reactions. So the plant needs non-cyclic photosynthesis. But there is another version of this process, which is called cyclic photosynthesis. Now, in cyclic photosynthesis, instead of using the photosystems II as a starting point, light hits photosystems I, all right? So this is happening at the same time that the non-cyclic is happening. Light hits photosynthesis I, and then the pigments capture the light, send it to each other, whatever, and eventually all the electrons, all the energy captured by all the pigments end up in the chlorophyll A reaction center, P700 reaction center, which is the photosynthesis I reaction center. And then that electricity gets bumped out of the photosystem into a primary electron acceptor. Now remember that if you're working with photosystems I, the primary electron acceptor is a group of iron and sulfur rich proteins which pretty much pick up these electrons to oxidize photosystems I, and then are going to transfer those electrons into ferredoxin. Now, normally, ferredoxin gets that those electrons and throws them into the truck. That's what happens during the non-cyclic photosynthesis. But in this case, instead of going towards the truck, the ferredoxin throws those electrons to plastoquinone. Now, I don't know if you remember from the other video, but basically, when plastoquinone gets charged, it picks up two hydrogen atoms from the stroma, and then it works together with cytochrome B6 complex to become back to normal and become oxidized again. But that oxidation will happen in the lumen, allowing the hydrogen atoms which were picked up in the stroma to be thrown into the lumen. So it's like, and then plastoquinone goes back to its uncharged state, this oxidized state. And then cytochrome is now reduced. But cytochrome complex takes those electrons and throws them to, we mentioned them last time, the plastocyanin. Plastocyanin will then take these electrons and send it back to photosystem I, which reduces it back to normal. Which means the electrons lost during photosystems I by light that went to ferredoxin, iron sulfur proteins, ferredoxin, plastoquinone, cytochrome complex, plastocyanin, and so forth. And meanwhile, pumped hydrogens into the lumen, all those electrons go back into the photosystem I, which means that this time the electrons don't end up in NADPH. So look at the difference here in the bottom. Instead of the electrons jumping out, down, up, down, and ending up in the truck, and meanwhile ATP is being made through pumping, this time ATP is still made through pumping, but the electrons go back where they started into photosystems I. So what's happening here is that the electrons are actually circling in a cyclic process that produces ATP through pumping but does not produce the NADPH. So the key thing is that this only involves photosystem I, which is the P700 system, rich in chlorophyll A. It does not produce NADPH. It does not require water because the electrons there's no need to replace electrons because electrons are not ending up in the truck, so there's no need to replace that. You also don't produce oxygen since water is not being split, but this is insufficient for the plant to survive because it is not making the NADPH truck, and that NADPH electron carrier truck is necessary for the Calvin cycle, which actually makes glucose to be produced. So if you don't have the NADPH, you're not going to do the Calvin cycle, you're not making glucose. What's the big deal? I'm still making ATP. Well, only if there's light. Once the light shuts down, this whole thing shuts down, and then if you don't have glucose, nighttime, plant cells that don't do this process, all of them die because they don't have the glucose to survive. So in order for the plants to survive in the long run, it's got to make glucose. To make glucose, it needs non-cyclic photosynthesis, which is the one that uses water to replace the electrons lost by the photosystems. So that means if the cell is in an environment that is not humid, it doesn't have humidity, it can't do non-cyclic photosynthesis. All it can do is cyclic photosynthesis. But then it doesn't make the truck, it doesn't make the light-independent reactions, it doesn't make glucose. So while the plant gets this extra ATP through this process, if it doesn't do the other process, it will in the long run die off when it goes into the dark, or it cannot feed the other cells which can't do this photosynthetic process. So this just is a remnant of a bacteria back in the day, and there's still some around. There's some bacteria, cyanobacteria, that do photosynthesis only through this process. But basically what they're forced to do is that when there's no light, the bacteria just basically shuts down, goes into hibernation mode, and waits for daytime to start up again. But plants cannot afford to be like that. They need to feed cells which can't do photosynthesis. They need to feed themselves during the night, and they need to do cell respiration everywhere, in every cell, including nighttime. So these cells will need non-cyclic photosynthesis in plants to produce glucose. So this is in the plant cells, this is kind of like a leftover of the cyanobacteria process that's still around in some cyanobacteria. And all it does for the plant cell, it produces a little more extra ATP. So since the chloroplast is an endosymbiont, maybe early in the history of the evolution of the chloroplast, that's how the chloroplast made its energy. But then the chloroplast actually evolved a cyclic process, and then that was better because it made glucose for later on, so that became present as well. But the plant can do both. But remember that this one will not be sufficient to power the cell in the long run. From here, we go into the dark reactions or the light-independent reactions that happen in the stroma, and what's actually what makes glucose.